The best answer here is E, venous infarction or parenchymal hemorrhage secondary to venous infarction. You can clearly see on CT there's an acute right parietal temporal parenchymal hemorrhage with surrounding edema. Now, at first glance, you see this linear hyperdensity that looked like subdural hemorrhage. So in your mind, you'll consider what could be the cause that causes subdural hemorrhage with parenchymal hemorrhage. On MRI, you see on SWI, there's quite a bit of susceptibility artifact, which is consistent with blood product. And on flare, you can see there's some edema. Now, because the history is that patient has recently diagnosed breast cancer, one thing that you definitely need to consider is hemorrhagic metastasis. And on this post-contrast T1, we do not see a discrete enhancing mass lesion. Although one can argue that you may have a small lesion that's been obscured by this large hemorrhage or by the mass effect, and that's possible too. So when we see a clear finding of acute parenchymal hemorrhage, we often consider some of the common etiology as we should, since like trauma, since like amyloangiopathy in older patient, AVM in younger patient, or in the case of primary neoplasm, you want to consider that this could be a hemorrhagic metastasis. Sometimes there are etiology that's not as common, but it's also important that we tend to overlook are things like venous infarction that leads to parenchymal hemorrhage. You can see that what's on the right side does not look like what's on the left. So on the left side, the transverse sinus enhanced normally. On the other hand, the right transverse sinus shows a large filling defect. So this is a case of venous infarction presenting with parenchymal hemorrhage, which is relatively common for venous infarction. So next time, if you see a parenchymal hemorrhage in a location that's adjacent to a major venous sinuses, such as transverse sinus, sigmoid sinus, or superior satchel sinus, in the parasagittal location, one thing that you need to consider is venous sinus thrombosis leading into venous infarction presenting with a parenchymal hemorrhage. Obviously, it's pretty easy to identify the filling defect on a contrast study like CT venogram. I think the trick here is try to find the venous sinus thrombosis on a non-contrast SCT. Now, this is a nice example of a patient presented with severe headache. This is a non-contrast exam. However, if you notice that the density in the posterior aspect of the superior sagittal sinus is denser compared to the anterior aspect of the superior sagittal sinus. So if you see this asymmetry in density, or for example, if you see the right side of the transverse sinus is denser than the left side, be very careful. Often that we do see increased density throughout the entire venous sinuses, and more commonly that's due to dehydration. But if I see asymmetry, I become very concerned. Now, if you have a post-contrast exam, CT venogram in this case, you can see that this patient's anterior aspect shows a nice opacification. The posterior aspect of the superior sagittal sinus, this triangular area, shows a large filling defect. It does not opacify normally. So that is the classic empty delta sign. You can also measure the Huntsville union. In this case, if you see the area without thrombosis, the Huntsville union on average is less than 50. On the other hand, the area of thrombosis, you can see that the Huntsville union on average is greater than 60. So that's something of concern. Clearly, there's asymmetry in density within the same sinuses. In this AJNR article, they found that if the Huntsville union greater than 70, the patient has venous sinus thrombosis. Obviously, there's not a clear-cut number, so you have to factor into clinical consideration as well. But in the day-to-day practice, if I see a Huntsville union of greater than 60, I become concerned. If I measure the Huntsville union of greater than 70, I become extremely concerned. So I'll pick up the phone, talk to the referring clinician of the ER physician, and check with them to see where the index of suspicion is for venous sinus thrombosis. Let's briefly look at other choices that do not work as well in this case. So choice A, hemorrhagic metastasis. Because the patient does have a recent history of breast cancer, one thing that you want to consider is metastasis or hemorrhagic metastasis. On the post-contrast T1, there is no discrete enhancing lesion to suggest metastasis, although again, it's possible that you have an underlying lesion that's been obscured by the large amount of blood product. So if you still have index suspicion that's relatively high for underlying lesion, a safe thing to do is follow-up study after resolution of the hemorrhage. Choice B, amyloangiopathy. On CT, you can see that this can represent a lobar hemorrhage. It's peripheral rather than central. However, the thing that does not fit is patient's age. This is a relatively young patient, and that does not fit amyloangiopathy. And also on SWI, you do not see any other signs of microhemorrhage or other previous hemorrhage. Whereas in this class example of amyloangiopathy in an 80-year-old patient, you see that there are multiple lobar hemorrhage in addition to multiple punctate susceptibility artifact represent multiple microblee. So that would be more classic for amyloangiopathy. Choice C, GBM. Now, GBM does have hemorrhagic component, but it's relatively uncommon for GBM to present with a large hemorrhagic mass. Also, classically, GBM shows the ugly RAM enhancement or peripheral enhancement with central necrosis. In this case, we do not see any indication of an underlying lesion. So GBM is not a good choice in this case. For choice D, this is a parenchymal hemorrhage or intraaxial hemorrhage, not a subarachnoid hemorrhage as you typically see with ruptured aneurysm. So combining with the finding of filling defect, venous sinus thrombosis, venous infarction is the best choice in this case. That is all for this brain case number 11. Good luck on your board exam. Thank you.